Thank you very much, the organizers, for inviting me to that event. I am asking you a question that you had just before the moment, but as you possibly might remember, 3 days ago, there was a Nobel Prize which was awarded for the discovery of the gravitational waves. And in the justification of award, giving that award, it was explicitly stated that black holes do exist. So if we believe in the power of the Nobel Committee to say what is true or not is not true in physics and in nature, then of course black holes do exist. But black holes are actually a quite old objects. The story is almost 240 years old. The concept emerged in 1780s. John Mitchell invented them. Laplace, as you will see in a moment, took that idea and then abandoned, and this idea had been forgotten for more than 100 years. I'm not sure how to operate this. I just want to move the picture by. Up. The second page, but the point is that I would like to see this second page piece by piece. Oh, okay. So John Mitchell, who had in his life an academic episode, he worked for about 15 years as a professor, I think at the Cambridge University, but I'm not quite sure what my memory is correct. Then he resigned and he went to a parish in one of Yorkshire parishes, sent a paper to Henry Cavendish under the title On the Means of Discovering the Distance, Magnitude of Fixed Stars, and so on. At that time, 1783, all stars had been fixed. Astronomers were not able to see the apparent motion of stars in the sky. And Mitchell proposed a scenario in which one could find distance to them in the case when they exist in binaries, in pairs. But the more interesting thing is that he discussed several issues, but the issue which was really interesting was that he stated, without explicit analytic calculations, that if there exists a star which is 500 times bigger than the Sun, and which has the same average mass density, then this star would become not visible. This calculation was absolutely correct. One could easily translate that into modern language. Such a star would be hidden under its Schwarzschild horizon. So in fact, it would be dark. Mitchell was a highly respected scientist. He was one of the two or three leading scientific figures in England. For instance, this famous Cavendish experiment was actually devised by Mitchell, who gave both the idea and this apparatus that he had at his disposal to Cavendish. And after his death, Cavendish made this famous experiment. I am giving those facts after Werner Israel, Dark Stars, The Evolution of an Idea, which was published in 1987. 1987. But nevertheless, Mitchell was not so famous as to have his own painting, as opposed to the next man who took the same idea, Laplace. Laplace published a book about the universe, and again, without specific explanations, he said something like Mitchell in his book about the universe, that stars which are big enough will not be visible. He was asked by a German editor of one of German scientific journals, to explain that, and he did it. So, in a paper which was written, which is interesting, in German, in a German journal, Allgemeine Geographische Ephemeriden, and was published in 1799. That was essentially this kind of calculations that our students of secondary school, in good secondary schools, could do. This is showing that if a star is big enough, then the escape velocity becomes larger than the speed of light, and therefore particles of light cannot escape the surface of that star, and the star becomes dark. The first question is whether Laplace was original or whether he borrowed that idea from Mitchell. There's one German scholar who investigated that issue, and he says that there was little scientific contact between England and France. That was the time of revolution, just before the French Revolution, just after the French Revolution. So the contacts between England and France had been very limited. And those three scholars, they say that probably there was no influence of Mitchell onto Laplace, because Laplace simply didn't know about what was done before. I talked on that issue last month with Thibaut Damour, a general relativist from France, and Thibaut Damour actually is not quite sure, because he said that he knows that Laplace could sometimes assign to himself things done by others. But anyway, what is really impressive is what happened later. Impressive, and it works in favor of Laplace. Namely, what was behind this result of Mitchell and Laplace was the understanding of light as ensemble of particles, essentially stones. The gravity is acting on light as on stones, and therefore this concept of the escape velocity is valid, and one could do this calculation. This is explicit quotation from Mitchell. Let us now suppose that particles of light to be attracted in the same manner as all other bodies with which are acquainted. And gravitation being, as far as we know, or having any reason to believe, an universal law of nature. There is the very explicit statement that light consists of particles. Mitchell died in 1798 or 1799. So the Young experiment, which showed the interference phenomenon for light, happened later. But I think that Laplace knew about that experiment. Whether that knowledge contributed to his decision to delete a passage about dark stars from the third edition of his book, which appeared in 1807, this is not clear. I asked one of my students to investigate that issue. I also did some quarantine. I asked people. Nobody really knows what happened. It is quite possible that Laplace, but there is still this possibility that Laplace realized that his argument does not apply to waves. If light, electromagnetic radiation, light is a kind of a wave, there is no way that Newtonian gravity would confine that to the surface, to the volume of a body. There would be no explanation why dark stars disappear, why dark stars do exist. So after 1808, that's the time when the third edition of his book appeared, the notion of black holes disappears. I would like to underline that that was a purely internal inconsistency. No observations that could contradict existence of dark stars, but just the fact that the nature of light was different from what was needed in order to show that stars would be dark. There's an interesting question, as I said, whether what was the reason that de Laplace deleted his this passage about dark stars from his book. It might happen that this question will never be answered, but on the other hand, the letters of Laplace to his friends and colleagues, which are apparently were not investigated by historians. So maybe if there is anyone in the audience interested in that, there is a chance to do something new. So this first prehistoric phase of the existence of black holes ends when, presumably, that's my conjecture, one of the two people who invented that concept realizes that there is an internal consistency, that light is a wave, and therefore he doesn't know what kind of argument could be used. Dark stars, or black holes, if you like, disappear now for more than 100 years until 1916. In 1915, in November, Einstein and more or less at the same time Hilbert formulate correct Einstein equations. And in April 1916, Karl Schwarzschild found his famous solution. Schwarzschild had been enrolled to the German army. He had been fighting in the Eastern Front. But then he came home for a kind of holiday. He found that equation and died afterwards because of typhus. What's interesting in this solution, this is a four geometry where R is the aerial radius. Here's a time. Here's a two element on the unit sphere. What's interesting that there is this correction factor in front of the infinitesimal of time and infinitesimal of the radius. And this correction term involves a quantity 2gm over c squared, which is just the quantity that was found before by Michel and Laplace. And when r, the radius is equal to this quantity of Michel and Laplace, then you have an apparent singularity. There is zero in front of dt squared and zero in front in the denominator of dr squared. So this fact that there was this singularity somehow repelled people from taking it seriously. Of course, there was a result by Belkov, which claimed that outside of massive body, this is the line element. And this is, of course, true. But the belief was at that time that this solution is not valid up to the radius being equal to the radius of Michel and Laplace. Einstein even produced a proof in 1937, 1938, which was published in one of Mexican journals, if I correctly remember. proving, showing that no rigid stationary structure would have size so small as the Schwarzschild radius. His result was that the smallest size of rigid structures is triple of Schwarzschild radii. And Einstein was absolutely correct. The problem is that black hole, as we know now, what was learned later, are not rigid structures. So that was one. So one reason was that apparent singularity at the horizon. The second was this conviction of Einstein. Also, it was quickly found that if one would compact the sun to its Schwarzschild radius, which is about 3 kilometers, then the density of that object would be extremely high, something of the order of 10 to the 16th grams per cubic centimeter. No astrophysical objects had been known at that time. Also, Schwarzschild himself considered a constant density spherical star, and he found that its minimal size must be larger than 8 over 8 of the Schwarzschild radius. And this result actually is true for any spherical star, which was shown 40 years later by Bugdal. So there were a number of arguments about understanding of the Schwarzschild solution as a solution describing physical reality. However, there was a progress made from 1920s until 1960. Painlever, Goldstrand, Lemaître, they found in 1920s regular forms of the Schwarzschild solution. There were forms in which the space-like geometry is flat. There exists a term which mixes radius and time, and nothing wrong happens at the horizon. Lemaître even explicitly stated that the Schwarzschild solution is manifestly regular. So evidently, that there was a kind of a polemic with the point of view which was prevalent at the time. But this information was not understood, and it was only 1950s when a situation changed. In 1960, John Wheeler sent for the publication a paper by Kruskal. That paper was written by John Wheeler. That's an interesting story. But that's probably because he assigned that to Kruskal, but that was probably because Wheeler felt guilty. Because Kruskal approached him about 1955 or 1956 with this paper, with his analytic continuation of the Schwarzschild metric, and somehow Wheeler didn't believe that. So it was only in 1960 when he became convinced, and then he sent this paper written by himself, but in the name of Kruskal, to the Physical Review Letters. Later on, there had been discoveries of spinning black holes, the Kerr solution, and then charged spinning black hole, Kerr-Newman solution, and there people discovered the maximal extensions. So from that time, the beginning of 1960s, black holes become this honorable status as good mathematical solutions. The book, the name of black hole, appeared for the first time in print in 1968, again due to John Wheeler. So that was this formal development, which was made in between 1920 and 1960. But there was also development from the physical or astrophysical side, namely Chandrasekhar and Landau and Gamow. They made conjectures concerning the existence of white dwarfs and later neutron stars. And neutron stars, in particular, they had been quite interesting because they would have very high internal densities, up to 10 to 15 of grams per cubic centimeter, only by a factor of 10 less than the Sun compacted to its Schwarzschild radius. So somehow, black hole started to lose its absurdal meaning. They had been close to the conjectured, but nevertheless conjectured physical reality. And in 1930s, Bader and Zwicky initiated search for neutron stars, which they associated with supernovae. And that led to first successful results in 1967, when pulsars had been discovered. We should mention also a work by Oppenheimer, Volkov, and Snyder, who have shown that the collapsing dust could form a black hole. And then arguments of Penrose, perhaps not quite conclusive, but nevertheless convincing, that formation of black holes are actually more generic than one could have think, that they could be produced not necessarily in spherically symmetric situations, but in a non-spherical setting as well. In 1980s, we have publications of Christodoulou and Kleinerman, who presented mathematical proofs accepted by the mathematical community that for some initial data, Schwarzschild black holes could be formed. On the astrophysical side, there was a realization that when matter falls onto a black hole, then a lot of energy is created. This is a highly efficient energetic process. I made a rough estimation that one teaspoon of water falling onto a black hole, a Schwarzschild black hole, could create the energy equivalent to one fuel tanker of petrol. And astrophysicists see many accreting systems. And they started to see them from 1960s. The famous example is Cygnus X1. This was the first object suspected to be a black hole. Its story is somehow wavy. There were periods that astronomers believed that Cygnus X1 is a black hole, and then they stopped to believe that, and then again resumed. The present understanding is, as far as I know, that Cygnus X1 is in fact a black hole. So it was found in 1964, but it's only recently that people came to this conclusion. There are also galactic sources of electromagnetic radiation, active galactic nuclei that could be associated with black holes. So this second period, which I call history of black holes, ends in mid-1990s, and then the status, mathematical status of black holes is firmly good. And there are also convincing observations. But that's interesting that in the case of black holes, observations started in the beginning of the 1960s when the mathematical structure had been well understood. So first solution, first correct mathematical solution, and then empirical observations. And now, the modern status of black holes. There's still some work which has to be done concerning mathematical investigations of black holes. One of the issues is, for instance, the stability issue. And clearly, as far as I know, the stability issue, even of Schwarzschild black holes, is not fully resolved. There's also question of the collapse that would create initial data. There are, again, new results by Christodoulou, Kleinman, Rudniansky, and Dafermos for simple physical, mathematical, it's better probably to say, models. But no real, no detailed description of a process that would lead from, say, a star, supermassive star, to the formation of a black hole. This astrophysical part of the process of formation of black holes is not well studied. There are many observations which confirm the existence of black holes, and the most convincing case is that concerning the center of the Milky Way. Here's the center. There's an object called Sagittarius A+. There's some structure around a jet, a stream of gas, which is which goes away from that black hole. And what is interesting that since the beginning of 1980s, astrophysicists, astronomers, they see a significant number, about 20 stars in the vicinity of that object. They could observe trajectories of those stars. And a few years ago, one of those stars, called S2, closed its trajectory. This is important because, similarly as in Newton, classical mechanics, internal classical mechanics, once you know the trajectory, then you can estimate the central mass, or you can calculate the central mass. And the central mass of that object inside of Sagittarius A plus is of the order of 4 million solar masses. The whole volume, which is enclosed by that star S2, is roughly 100 times bigger than the volume which is underneath the trajectory of Pluto around the Sun. So in a relatively small volume, we have a mass of 4 million stars. So there's a plausibility argument that the only object that could survive for longer is a black hole. This picture is made from observation dating from 1992 to 2002, so the trajectory was not close at that time. There are certainly new pictures, but somehow I was not able to find them in the time that I had in my disposal. So the black hole inside of the Milky Way is probably the strongest argument in favor of the existence. I should mention now a new observational project, which had been investigated in the last year. Actually, there are two projects, but these leaders of those two projects collaborate with themselves, Doleman from the American side and Falke, Kramen, and Rezzola from the European side. They want to see the horizon of that black hole. The idea is that by combining all radio telescopes, which exist, not all, but the largest one, which exists on the Earth, one gets resolution which is good enough to see details of the horizon of the black hole. So the result would be as in this picture. There are many luminous sources around, but there is this dark point inside, and that dark point is an event horizon. This is an artistic imagination, does not result from any observation, but this is what is expected, that somehow the fact that the horizon of black hole does not radiate would manifest itself in the observation. Now there is a very new important class of data concerning black holes, which refers to what I said in the very beginning, to that recent Nobel Prize. Namely, the understanding is that those gravitational waves had been created in coalescence of binary stars, of pairs of black holes, of binary black holes. There were four such incidents. There is something which I myself have difficulty in understanding with that, but that was crucial for the identification of those black holes. These are this finite collapse in each of those four cases was always associated with damped oscillating radiation. There was an output which consisted of damped oscillations. And this is an old story which starts in 1968 when Vishveshwara, a PhD student with Misner in Maryland, did numerical studies. He sent pulses of radiation to black holes, and he discovered that in particular situations that radiation incident onto a black hole could be reflected. That particular situation was that when the pulse of radiation was dominated by length waves close to the Schwarzschild radius. That's the condition for that reflection. That was a numerical result in 1968 when he started that investigation. Computers were not very good. I talked to one of general relativists from the United States, Mashun, who also had been doing his PhD at that time in Princeton, but he knew about Vishveshwara, and he told me that at that time people didn't believe in numerical results. So that result of Vishveshwara was somehow not evaluated in such a way as it should. But in mid-1980s, a British mathematical physicist, Lever, he investigated that issue purely analytically, and he found that perturbed black holes could emit radiation, and that radiation would carry information both about the mass of that black hole and also about its spin. So this damped ringing radiation, oscillating radiation, is something which is very specific to a black hole. This is, say, people with musical ear, they could learn whether someone is playing violin or someone is playing drum. So that's this kind of situation. And then since 1990, many people came to the conclusion that discovery of black hole of quasi-normal ringing would be the strongest argument for the existence of black holes. And since that happened in those recent detections, then presumably what played a role in those, in those processes leading to those detections. They were black holes. But there's one unclear thing, which I myself have difficulty. That's the example of how quasi-normal modes look like. So one can specify a perturbation close to a black hole. That perturbation goes out, it reaches infinity, and then it becomes exponentially decaying with those oscillations. That picture is coming from my own paper, which was published in 2002, and I know that the situation that would lead to this picture was very special. One would have to specify perturbations close to the black hole in a very special way to have this clear image of damped oscillating Gaussian waves. And the question is why in LIGO they detected always in those four cases, those damped oscillations. It is known, again, since early 1990s, that quasi-normal modes don't constitute full functional basis. It is not like exponential function or sine and cosine functions, which can be treated as a base for, say, L2 integrable functions. Those ringing modes, they certainly don't have this property. So this is an open question why they always detect those damped oscillations. Thibaut d'Amour, in a lecture given about a month ago, he said explicitly that those damped oscillations, they have always to occur. That's probably empirical observation. They, in the process of preparing scenarios for results of coalescences of black holes, they describe first in the analytical, then numerically, two black holes which circulate each and about another. And probably it was always the case that after coalescence, they observed quasi-normal ringing. But there's no mathematical proof. And as I said, I don't see easy way to have such a proof. Okay, so I repeat again that this Nobel Prize is, in a sense, recognition of the existence of black holes. There's another class of evidence that shows that there exist black holes. These are observations in which matter is falling onto black holes, the so-called accretion phenomena. There are many of such examples. Here you see a list in Wikipedia of galactic candidates for black holes. These are always black holes in binaries with a normal star, and matter from the normal star is falling to a black hole, and then it is visible, and one can estimate the mass of that black hole. So there's this group of galactic candidates for black holes. And here we see even a much larger group of candidates for active galactic nuclei in various galaxies, with masses starting from 40 billion solar masses up to a couple of million masses. So in conclusion, the first conclusion is for physicists. So I just say that black holes seem to exist in physics. They exist as good analytical solutions. And there are many observational data which confirm their existence. The conclusion for philosophers, I try to rely to guess what kind of conclusion would be interesting for philosophers. So this is what I found, is that black holes have interesting history. This is a purely theoretical invention. The first concept fall apart because it was inconsistent, without even attempt to find confrontation with observations. And then they had been revived after creation of general relativity, understood almost 50 years after discovery of Einstein equations. And then after the next 50 years, the evidence that we have from observations is essentially compelling. They do exist. Thank you very much.